lineup.
Well, welcome to you all today. Although Marta and I organized this year's speaker series, in fact, it was Mark Tobin who was the driving force behind bringing David Levy to speak to us today. So I'm going to turn it over to him to introduce today's speaker. So.
Thank you very much, Catherine. Well, to start out, I would like to thank not just Catherine and Marta, but the Department of History and Heidi and Chris for being amazing supports for this event. And I also want to thank the Center for Planetary Science and Exploration and the Department of Physics and Astronomy, as well as Public History at Western, Public Humanities at Western, the Victorian Reading Group in the Department of English. They all chipped in when it was needed, and the Royal Astronomical Society of Canada did as well. So David Levy is a world-famous astronomer with interdisciplinary interests in astronomy and history and English literature. Levy is one of the most successful comet discoverers in history, having discovered 22 comets. These include, with Eugene and Carolyn Shoemaker, Shoemaker Levy 9, which was the comet that famously collided with Jupiter in 1994. Levy is currently involved with the Jarnac Sky Comet Survey based at Jarnac Observatory in Vail, Arizona, has published 35 books and numerous articles on astronomy. He was awarded an Emmy in 1998 for the Discovery Channel documentary 3 Minutes to Impact. David was science editor for Parade magazine from 1997 to 2006, a contributing editor for Sky and Telescope. For Sky and Telescope magazine, is that right? Mm-hmm. Yeah. And writes for each issue of the Canadian magazine Sky News. Levy has appeared on many television programs, including The Today Show, Good Morning America, the National Geographic special Asteroids, Deadly Impact, and ABC's World News Tonight. He has been awarded 5 honorary doctorates. And asteroid 3673, Levy, was named in his honor. He holds a PhD from the Hebrew University of Jerusalem for his thesis, The Sky in Early Modern English Literature, a Study of Allusions to Celestial Events in Elizabethan and Jacobean Writing, 1572-1610, which I gather is, we're going to be hearing just a little bit about that story and that method today. Published by Springer in 2011. His publications also include More Things in Heaven and Earth, Poets and Astronomy Read the Night Sky, and Starry Night, Poets and Astronomers Read the Sky from Prometheus Press in 2001. Ladies and gentlemen, I give you David Levy.
Thanks so much, Mark. I appreciate that introduction. It's kind of nice to sit down here and sort of reminisce on and see if I've done anything to merit it worthwhile for me to give a colloquium to you today. And I'm thinking, well, the old man has done a few things. So, okay, here we go. I'd like to begin a talk by giving you an informal subtitle to this talk, which was really going to be Talk, Text, and Tunes, because there is going to be some music that goes along with this presentation. The text, however, has nothing to do with your cell phones. So I would ask you unless you get a really important phone call from your girlfriend or boyfriend or something like that, you might want to turn your telephone off. The text refers to, hung be the heavens with dark, yield day to night, comets importing change in times and states, brandish your crystal tresses in the sky. That's not something that you'd be likely to text on your cell phone. That's actually from Shakespeare. Not only is it from Shakespeare, it might have been, although it probably wasn't the first thing that the man ever wrote. It's the first 3 lines of Henry VI, Part 1. There were a number of plays like Midsummer Night's Dream, but Two Gentlemen of Verona and other plays that might have been produced before that. But Henry VI, Part 1 is probably one of the earliest plays that William Shakespeare wrote. And I knew absolutely nothing about Shakespeare when I got interested in astronomy. I should have, however. because I like to think that it was my dad that got me interested in Shakespeare and the night sky, which has become a real passion for me in recent years. Shakespeare was a tremendous passion for my father. He read all of the Shakespeare canon, not just the plays, but the poems and the sonnets and the other material that he wrote. He probably even read Shakespeare's will. And he probably even thought that if my children do not get interested in Shakespeare, if they do not inherit my love of Shakespeare, I'm going to disown them. I just kind of think that might have happened. And of course, the tunes is that astronomy, the talk text and tunes implies that astronomy is not just for astronomers. Otherwise, we wouldn't be giving this presentation right now. And instead, it is meant for the rest of us. For the rest of us who are reading, who are wondering, and who are thinking about the night sky, who are thinking about things that are other than politics, which is really grabbing a lot of us right now, and imagining what's going to happen. I have to tell you that living in the United States, we had just gotten settled to what's happening there right now, and I get into Canada, and the person at the border says, "You're from the United States, huh?" I said, "Yeah." And he said, "Okay, tell me what's going on down there right now." And he said, "I heard this on CNN, and I heard this on MSNBC, and Fox News says that, and what am I supposed to do?" And all I could say was take a deep breath and hope we're still able after a while to continue. But in any event, there's an awful lot to imagine about the night sky and its beauty. I have the opening slide with four images. The one on the far left is an eclipse of the sun. It is not an eclipse that happened recently. It is one that I saw on October the 2nd, 1959. And it was a very long time ago. I was only 11 years old. I doubt very many of you were alive in 1959, but I was just a kid. I really wanted to see this, and it was cloudy. But the sky cleared just enough near the end that we were able to get that. And that's the first eclipse that I ever saw. It is also the first numbered observing session I've ever had. And you can actually see the list of observing sessions I've had since 1959. And right now I think it's about 19,470 or something like that that I've had since then. And they're all recorded on the website of the Royal Astronomical Society of Canada, every one of them. And I saw an eclipse just last Friday before coming here. It was the 90th eclipse that I've seen in my life. And if you count everything from eclipses of the moon, eclipses of the sun, total eclipses, penumbral eclipses, everything, I try to spend as much time as I can in the shadow of the earth and in the shadow of the moon. There's another picture of an eclipse I saw more recently, transit of Venus, that I saw. There were two of them, one in 2004, which this one is, and another one in 2012. Do any of you know when the next transit of Venus will take place? You don't know and you don't care, because none of us will be around to see it, not a single one. Unless you can add another 111 years to your lives and still be around, that's when the next transit of Venus is going to be. I also brought along a picture of a telescope. This is not the most obvious telescope that you want to have in your backyard, but it is in somebody's backyard. It was in the backyard of the Earl of Ross. He was in Ireland, and he decided he wanted to have a telescope to enjoy the night sky with, but he wanted to make it better than any other telescope in the world, and it was. It is a 72-inch diameter telescope, which was the largest telescope on Earth from 1845, when it was opened, to 1917, when it was superseded at last by the 100-inch telescope on Mount Wilson. And so for many, many years, decades, this was the largest telescope in the world. Would you like to see Mars through the largest telescope in the world? Okay, that's it. That's Mars. Right there. You're actually looking through the telescope because the telescope has these two mountings over there, and your eyes are going through in between the mounts to see Mars shining there. And that's that. And Mars is going to come in a little bit later in some of the literature I'd like to discuss with you. But in his first year of observing, the third Earl of Ross was out of the eyepiece, and that's a sort of a period he's sort of hanging by the cables and hanging for dear life by the cables, hoping that he's not going to fall down. And he was able to look at something that he thought very unusual. He thought it was a cloud of gas that he interpreted as being planetary system, which might be just being formed. And he drew it. It's this one. It turns out that he had seen a spiral galaxy deep in the midst of space. The spiral galaxy that he saw is known as Messier 51. It was discovered by Charles Messier. It was observed by him and added to his catalog. And it's really a beautiful, beautiful galaxy. And there's two of them. There's this main one, and then there's another one, which is probably interacting with this one somehow. And he drew that sketch. It must have taken him about an hour to draw it, as the Earth was rotating the galaxy over across through the field of the telescope until he lost it about an hour later. And at the time, Camille Flammarion was also working on astronomy. He was writing a book about astronomy for beginning observers, people mostly in France who wanted to study the night sky and get into it. It's a wonderful book. It's been translated into English. I don't think it's still available, but I was able to get a secondhand copy a few years ago. And if you open at the frontispiece on that book is this sketch. And this sketch is what the Earl of Ross drew, and that was done there. And I'm certain that one of the people who walked into a bookshop to pick up that book was a young artist named Vincent van Gogh. I'm pretty certain of that. We've all heard of Vincent van Gogh. He had a few emotional problems, but we don't worry about the emotional problems. But we do concern ourselves about with that he is one of the most talented, brilliant minds in Earth's history. And he saw this and he was entranced by this sketch. Some of you may know that a lot of Vincent van Gogh's paintings are done using mirrors. So when he decided to do this sketch, he probably used a mirror, which kind of made it look like that. And it sort of inverted the image a little bit. So he never did a painting of that, or did he? Maybe he did. What do you think? Does this here look a little bit like that? And was he looking at Lord Ross's drawing of Messier 51, as seen in a mirror, and made it as the center of his magnificent painting, Starry Night? We don't know, but we suspect so. It remains one of the most beautiful galaxies I have ever seen, one of the most beautiful things in the night sky I have ever seen. And one of the things Van Gogh wrote, and I've probably forgotten it, but I'll try to remember it, was typically modest of him. He says, I know nothing about anything, but the sight of stars makes me dream. And there he is, and there it is. We have better pictures of the Whirlpool Galaxy right now. Here is one of them. This was taken a few years ago by our Hubble Space Telescope. And it was made with pictures, little pictures that are about that size. And they were able to stitch them together to put in the entire galaxy there. And the original one, I saw the original one made as a poster, and it would stretch across this table from here to your end over there. It was enormous. Can I get a slightly smaller version of that? Yeah, it's online, so I was able to get it. And you can see it if you want on the Hubble Heritage site. It's one of the finest images ever taken, ever taken by the Hubble Space Telescope. And it's just Google Hubble Heritage and then look up and you should be able to see that. I don't think they mentioned Van Gogh in there, but I'm pretty sure there is a connection. And then over the years, we come to eclipses. This is not an eclipse, unless the clouds are eclipsing the sun in this picture. I took this picture when I was visiting Barcelona on October the 6th. This always does this. October the 6th, 2005. And what I remembered was that it was exactly 400 years earlier that an eclipse of the sun took place on that, at this exact spot in Barcelona. And if I'd been there just 400 years earlier, I would have been able to get that picture surrounded by this crescent moon of the sun, but in eclipse. And I don't know if the weather was the same as that, but it certainly could have been. But that's a picture of the sun taken 400 years later. Shakespeare wrote an awful lot about eclipses. He wrote a huge amount of material about eclipses. And when I was an undergraduate student at Acadia University taking Shakespeare class, I studied them, and King Lear especially. You know, you have the opening of King Lear. It begins with a very polite beginning, you know, they're talking to each other and the aged king is wanting to divide up his kingdom among his three daughters. And he's wondering how he's going to do it. And he creates this test of love to make sure that his three daughters want to love him enough that he can divide the kingdom. And what he says is that I'm going to divide the kingdom so that I, unburdened, can crawl to death. Which sounds like a reasonable thing. And the first two daughters give him these wonderful speeches how much they love him and nothing else is more important. Reagan is saying that I love you even more than my sister does. And her sister says, I love you more than Reagan does. And then it's time for Cordelia, and he looks at Cordelia and he says, now you are my favorite. So how much do you love me? What do you have to say to express your love for your father? And she stands up and she looks around. She says, nothing, my lord. And King Lear says, nothing will come of nothing. Speak again. He says, I love you according to my bond, nothing more and nothing less. And excuse me, a little bit of time needed for some petrol here. And so King Lear has this humongous temper tantrum, and he disinherits his daughter. He divides the kingdom up into two pieces for each of his older daughters. And he says, I'm going to go away and spend the night with my older daughter, then my younger daughter, and Cordelia can go to hell as far as I'm concerned. It turns out that Cordelia is the only one of his daughters that has any affection for her father. And by this time, Lear is getting angry. It's the tyranny of his old age is really getting to him. And he comes to visit his older daughter's house. And the older daughter says, fine, but all your servants have to stay outside. He says, what do you mean? I'm the king of England. He says, no, you're not. I am. I'm the queen and you're nothing. And so he storms out from the older daughter's house, tries to go to Reagan's house. And Reagan says, you alone are allowed. Nobody else can come in. And maybe you should stay outside as well. which gets him even angrier that now all three of his daughters have rejected him, and he goes off into the forest, and there's the storm. And the storm scenes begin, and never forget the stage directions in my copy of the Shakespeare I used at the time. Scene 3, storm still. Scene 4, storm still. Sounds like the weather we've had here in the last few days. Storm still, it just doesn't stop. Meantime, back at the palace, Gloucester is really upset by what Lear has done, correctly it turns out. And he's pacing around. Hope I don't trip over anything, but he's pacing around the floor. And he's working himself into a frenzy. And he has two sons, Edmund and Edgar. And one of them is trying to work him up into an even greater rage. And the other one is actually trying, the bastard son, is trying to calm him down a little bit. But he's going off into all kinds of directions about what these times are heralding. And then he gets to this line: "These late eclipses of the moon and sun pretend no good to us." And believe it or not, Shakespeare spends the next two pages talking about eclipses. The play stops. Lear is off out in the woods somewhere, and Gloucester is going, he's giving us an astronomy lecture in what is widely believed to be Shakespeare's greatest play. It goes on for two pages in the play. And you wonder, what is going on here? Is Shakespeare an astronomer? Back then at Acadia, did I do anything about it, being very interested in astronomy at the time? No. It just went sailing through my little brain, out in one ear and out the other. I may actually made a note of it in the margin, the eclipse passages, without saying, this is my future. I just sort of did that and forgot about it. And it wasn't until years later that I was outside, not reading Shakespeare, but watching for shooting stars. It was in April of 1977. And I was in Montreal, where I was living at the time, looking up at the night sky, watching meteors or shooting stars coming down from the constellation of Lyra. It was the end of April of 1976, sorry. And I was thinking, I'm wondering how many other people in ancient times past, also looked at these meteors and also wondered what I'm wondering. And then, being a little older than I thought, could any of these people written about them? And suddenly I thought of Shakespeare, thought of King Lear, and I thought of the eclipses. So there I was, back to this eclipse. Took place in 2005, the only picture of the eclipse that I've been able to get, except that it's taken only 400 years after the event takes place. I would like to think of Shakespeare, if he were miraculously to come back to life, and he looks up on the web, you can see him doing that, and he finds out that I'm giving a colloquium here, and he says, this might be fun. And so there he is, sitting in the back there. And so a couple of you sort of go over and say, hello, Mr. Shakespeare. It's nice to see you again after all these entries. And he sort of nods and says, hello. And you say, why did you write King Lear the way you did? Did you want to put the eclipses into it as much as you did? And did you want to do this? Did you want to do that? And he says, listen, I came back after 400 years. I don't want to talk about my plays at all. I want to learn how to use the cameras that took these pictures. And I want you guys to show me how to do that. That's why I'm here. I have a feeling that if Shakespeare were here now, he'd be using the internet. He'd probably have a cell phone, and it would be blocked all the time. And but whatever the case, he'd sure be wanting to follow all of the latest trends in technology, which is what he did when he was alive. He wrote about eclipses. He wrote mostly about the effects of these eclipses, because he was writing as more as an astrologer than an astronomer. And the reason for that is not that he was interested in or followed astrology, because he probably did not. If you want some evidence of that, go to Sonnet 14. Not from the stars do I my judgment pluck. He starts it out by saying that. But then in a twist at the end, he kind of says, well, maybe there's something to it. But he begins that by saying that he doesn't follow astronomy. Then the second line is, and yet methinks I have astronomy. He certainly knows a lot about the astronomy of the time. And it went into his material, almost every possible thing, as it went into the material of later writers. There's one in particular that took place, and this is something, again, that I got from my father. When I started to get interested in Shakespeare, he said, it's not just Shakespeare that I want you to be interested in. Shakespeare lived in a time when many writers were very good, and I'm going to point out two of them in particular. And he pointed out Beaumont and Fletcher. And he said, they wrote as a collaboration. And I listened patiently to what he had to say and then totally forgot about it till I was doing my dissertation at the Hebrew University. And I had a few hours to spend in a library in Western Canada, actually at UBC. And I looked up one of Beaumont and Fletcher's plays. And in the very beginning of it, as like it's somewhere in one of the first scenes, it says, it's so much, and yet the morn not up. There's people standing outside looking at the dawn. See yonder where the shamefaced maiden comes into our sight. How gently doth she slide, hiding her chaste cheeks like a modest bride with a red veil of blushes. He was pointing out the constellation of Virgo in the morning sky just before dawn. There's only one time of year he could do that, and that's December. December 1605, when he probably wrote, when he and the two of them, Beaumont and Fletcher, wrote that play. It was called The Woman Hater. And he wrote those things about standing outside and watching the constellation of Virgo rising just before the dawn. It's only one time of year can do that. And I thought, well, why would he write about that? Because other than Spica, the brightest star in the constellation, there's really no reason to see Virgo. It's all a bunch of shamefaced, very faint stars. And except not in 1605, because Mars was right there next to Spica, forming two little eyes. And he even mentions it by talking about a red veil of blushes, probably referring to the redness of one of those eyes, which was Mars. Now, Mars didn't stay very long next to Spica. It moved along in its orbit around the sun and around the sky very quickly, didn't it? And then it was gone, and Spica resumed its one-eyed appearance that it always has. So why do I mention that? And that is because now, again, about 400 years later, you can see Virgo as a two-eyed constellation, because there's another planet there, not Mars this time, but Jupiter. If you look at the night sky, and it's no longer December, now it's late February, so instead of rising just before dawn, Virgo rises around midnight, and by around 1 or 2 in the morning, it's fairly high in the sky, and by dawn, it's already starting to sink in the west. And if you look at Virgo now, you'll be able to identify it by seeing the big planet Jupiter right there next to Spica, about where Mars was 400 years earlier. And it's kind of interesting to think about how the passage of that planet might have caught the author's attention, to use the metaphor of a constellation in the sky to open up a play about the modest bride. And that brings us kind of away from Shakespeare and into something a little bit later. And here we come to Gulliver's Travels by Jonathan Swift. Let me ask you a question. Who discovered the moons of Mars? Phobos and Deimos. It's an astronomy question, but it's kind of a trick as well. Who discovered them? Well, if you, do you know?
Yeah.
Well, if you don't know it, then I don't know if anybody does, and I don't even know. Well, I do. I think I was expecting that one of you would have said Asaph Hall, yes, at the U.S. Naval Observatory in 1878. Yeah, and I would have had to say it's wrong. He didn't. The person who I believe discovered the moons of Mars is this guy, Jonathan Swift. And he wrote about his so-called discovery in 1726, 150 years later, earlier than Asaph Hall's observation. He didn't discover them, but he did predict their existence in Gulliver's Travels, not in his first book about the Lilliputians, not in his second book about those great big Brobdingnagians, but in the third book, where he's talking about the flying island. You remember that, Laputa? The flying island? Some of you may be familiar with that if you haven't read Gulliver yet. You might be familiar with that from Star Trek. You've all seen the original series. There is an episode in season 3 called The Cloudminders that deals with a city in the clouds. That's lifted straight out of Jonathan Swift. And I know that because Jonathan Swift came by in a dream and he wanted to sue the writers of Star Trek. And I said, well, that was 50 years ago. I mean, kind of the statute of limitations has run out on that. And he says, well, I was around 300 years ago. And I said, well, forget it. I took care of that one. Anyway, Jonathan Swift, he predicted in writing about this flying island filled with scientists and astronomers, and he describes that Mars has two moons. And he got the first one the right size, and the second one, the smaller one, the right size. He got their orbits approximately correct. And all that was needed after he described it in his book was to leave it to someone else like Asaph Hall to actually see them in 1878, 150 years later. I think it's kind of an interesting thing that such a major discovery as that would be predicted by an author, Dean Swift, so many years earlier. One of the other things that he might have probably talked about was about Mars. An Italian astronomer named Schiaparelli did these lovely sketches of the planet Mars with a very large telescope, and he recorded these canals on the planet. And they were kind of sort of left there until a very famous American amateur astronomer named Percival Lowell decided that he wanted to see them through a telescope. And that was this telescope that he had at the observatory named after him, Lowell Observatory in Flagstaff. He did so many sketches of Mars, and he sketched what he thought were canals. And then went all the way into 1965, when the Mariner 4 spacecraft, passing in situ right next to Mars, photographed the region where Percival Lowell, Uncle Percy, had his canals. Did they photograph any? No. And I'll never forget the headline in the New York Times that day, Mars at noon, no canals. It was a sad thing. It was kind of like the final nail in the coffin of Percival Lowell and his attempts to confirm that there were canals and therefore life on Mars. The reason that Lowell felt that way was that he was a pacifist. He wanted to see peace throughout the world, which there were more people like him. And he thought that if he could get the people of the world to appreciate that the people of Mars had built a canal system to save their dying planet, then maybe they might come together on Earth as well. But you see, the point that I'm trying to get to with all these writers is that just as astronomy isn't meant for astronomers, it's meant for the rest of us, so is literature, so is music, so is art. It's meant for all of us to appreciate and to enjoy. In 1965, there was a well-known writer that very few of you study in literature classes. His name was Leslie Peltier. And he wrote, in the very beginning of his most famous book called Starlight Nights, he wrote these words. And it's just incredible, you know, when you go outside at night and the sky is getting dark and you look up, and we all kind of wonder, anything unusual here? A bright comet up here, definitely the northern lights might be here. What is the phase of the moon? Are there any shooting stars we'll be able to see? It is so interesting to be able to figure. And it is a set of mystery. And it takes us away from the normal day-by-day activities of what we get on the news stations. And it certainly takes me to a place where I could be looking through a telescope and seeing the Milky Way and seeing other things in the night sky, doing what I love to do more than anything else, which is, or was, the search for comets. But I think my time for comets has passed. I can say now that even though I spent over 50 years with a telescope like that one, searching for comets, I think I have to admit that the comets that are found now are almost entirely going to be found by professionals with great big telescopes, electronic cameras, and, you know, I remember one of the books that I've written was called Clyde Tombaugh, Discoverer of Planet Pluto. Have to change the name of that right now and make planet out of it, I guess. That's another talk. Anyway, I thought that I would be talking about finding about the man who discovered Pluto, and I asked him one night to tell me about the discovery, and boy, it was exciting how he, the feeling that he had when he first noticed the two images moving from one picture to the other. He knew by the amount of motion right away that he had figured out that this had to be an object farther away than Neptune. So he knew he had it. Then when they started finding these newer planets, and well, we found a lot of them, on using CCDs and electronic cameras, I asked the discoverer of one of the earliest ones of those to describe his experiences. And he said, well, I was asleep, but the next day I got up and had breakfast, and I was having a pizza lunch. I was watching the monitors, and there it was. End of story. I thought, do you have any feeling? Did you think about it or anything? Did it do anything to you? No. He went on to something else, as if it had no emotion at all. And I think that's one of the things that's been lost in our modern culture. It is so mechanized, so computerized, that we've forgotten some of the poetry of it. We've forgotten some of the romance, the art, the music. We've forgotten to go back. Whoops. One should not lean on the... what am I doing here? One should definitely not lean on the laptop during a lecture. Wait a minute. What am I doing? There we are. There. Okay. I had the privilege of visiting Stratford on Avon in England a number of years ago and get this picture. It's commonly known as the birthplace. But it's a lot more than that. This is the place where William Shakespeare was born, where he grew up, and where I believe his father said one evening, Will, come with me outside. And the two people went outside, probably the backyard back there, with a view to the north. And he pointed out, do you see that very, very bright star over there? And the young 8-year-old said, yeah. What's its name? He said, it doesn't have a name. It's new. It is a nova. We now know it as an exploding star, and we now know it as Tycho's star, discovered by the great Tycho Brahe in 1577, when William Shakespeare was 8 years old. And I got that one wrong. Let me backtrack a bit. Discovered in 1572, when young William Shakespeare was definitely about 8 years old. And he never forgot it. And there is a possibility, if you read the opening of Hamlet, his most famous play, there's a section where I think it was Marcello talks about guarding the castle. And he mentions, last night, when yon same star that's westward from the pole, and he points to an area there in the north. There's no star there, no bright star there. There are a few faint ones, but no bright ones. There is a constellation there called Cassiopeia. He's pointing to precisely the place where in 1572, when Shakespeare was about 8, there was an exploding star. And it might have gotten its way into Hamlet. We can't guarantee it. I don't know if it'll hold up in court, but I think it's an idea. Okay, alternative facts. Okay. Sorry about that. Okay, this is a picture of a beautiful park in Stratford. There was a house there years ago, centuries ago, called New Place. It was bought by William Shakespeare, and he retired there. The house is long since gone, but they made a park out of it, and you can tell the town around it is building up very rapidly, and it's still a beautiful park where Shakespeare spent many a wonderful hour. As we go forward in English literature, we get to, there are a lot of writers who enjoyed the night sky. A lot of them. One of them is Gerard Manley Hopkins. He is the one that I wrote my MA thesis on, because by that time I was really committed into the idea that the night sky in English literature had a role to play. And I was also committed to know that Hopkins was one of the players, one of the big players. How many of you have read The Windhover? No one's going to admit to it? Oh, it's a terrible beast of a poem. Actually, it's a wonderful poem, but it's almost impossible to read because he's using sprung rhythm and all kinds of things that characterize the man's later poetry. And most people, when they think of Gerard Manley Hopkins, think of someone who is really very difficult to read. And then they come to this poem written when he was a student at Oxford, undergraduate student, and it's called, I Am Like a Slip of Comet, Scarce Worth Discovery. In some corner seen, bridging the slender difference of two stars. But when she sights the sun, she grows and sizes and spins her skirts out, while her central star shakes its cocooning mists. And so she comes to fields of light. Millions of traveling rays pierce her. She hangs upon the flame-cased sun and sucks the light as full as Gideon's fleece. But then her tether calls her. She falls off, and as she dwindles, sheds her smock of gold amidst the sistering planets. So I go out. My little sweet is done. I have drawn heat from this contagious sun. To not ungentle death, now forth I run. The speaker in the poem is comparing herself to a comet. Gets very bright, rounds the sun, and then backs away and disappears. And that became the heart of the master's thesis that I did. And I was very interested in comets. At the time, I had not discovered any. That would come about 10 years later. And about 25 years before I co-discovered this comet. Those are the discovery images of the comet now known as Shoemaker-Levy 9. and it collided with Jupiter. And in history, it is known as the first major impact between two solar system objects, a comet and a planet. It's the first one we've seen. There may have been others, although probably not. But that's the first one witnessed by humanity. It was as if they took all of the nuclear weapons on Earth, put them into a great big bag and lit them, and exploded them all at once, multiplied that by several thousand times, and then you get the explosion of these comets as they collided with Jupiter. That, again, is a subject of a different talk. But I did want to show you some pictures that I have of the comet. There are a number of pictures that will be shown during the first stanza of the song that I will play, and a number of pictures of the impacts that will be shown during the second stanza of the song that I will play. And the song that I'm going to play, the music, is called The Lady in Red. The reason I chose that is that when I first met my wife, Wendy, and my then future wife, Wendy, in Las Cruces, New Mexico, she was dressed in this beautiful red getup. It was just so beautiful. I didn't fall in love with her at that, but it certainly attracted me and got us going. Anyway, let's enjoy some images of Comet Shoemaker-Levy 9 and its impact to Lady in Red.
Such a feeling.
Get to the end of our session today, there's just one more little thought that I'd like to share with you, and that is the idea of how I came across this interdisciplinary thing. I am sure that there are many people, in fact, many here in London, Mark is one of them, Peter Jedecky is another, who are giants in the field of astronomy, who know the sky better than I do, better than almost anybody in the world. They're terrific people. The only thing I can still say about what I do is that I don't know of anyone quite as passionate about the night sky as I am. And I'd like to close with a couple of things. There's another song that I would like to play. And it was written by a classmate of mine when I was in elementary school and then again in high school, although he was in that class about 10 years before I was. His name was Leonard Cohen, and he wrote many magnificent songs. The first of my favorites of his was Suzanne, but then came Hallelujah. And I spend so much time trying to choose the best version of this song as we're talking about looking out at the sky during the night, and it proves that I have been someone very acquainted with the night. I've walked out in rain and back in rain. I've outwalked the farthest city light. I have been one acquainted with the night. Well, these are just interesting images of the night sky, mostly taken by another first-class amateur astronomer named Roy Bishop of Nova Scotia. Not all of them were taken by him, but a lot of them were. Let's enjoy these two, Leonard's song, Hallelujah. And the one that I chose to play for you is my personal favorite, the original one in 1984. Although I think that Kate McKinnon's version, if any of you heard that on Saturday Night Live, right after the American election, I think it's the second. That was absolutely wonderful. So here goes.
Yeah.
think there's a little bit more of it here, but I think Leonard's decided to take a break. And we have a picture of a total eclipse of the sun through all the phases. Here, actually, an annular eclipse of the sun. Picture of Apollo 17 on its launch pad, 30-second exposure during which the lightning flash takes place. And that's the final Apollo mission heading to the moon. What it shows what humanity can do if it sets its mind and heart to it. We have the crescent moon. We're back. What better place to show a rainbow from the home of the birthplace of the man who discovered why rainbows take place? This is a rainbow over Isaac Newton's birthplace.
Wow.
Ralph Hodgson, standing on a low hill, possibly somewhere on a campus like this one, might have looked up at the night sky when he wrote, "I stood and stared. The sky was lit. The sky was stars all over it. I stood, I knew not why. Without a wish, without a will, I stood upon that silent hill and stared into the sky until my eyes were blind with stars. And still I stared into the sky." Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you all for coming today. I know that we're on the hour, so if some of you have to leave, by all means do. I think we might have time for just a few questions. There are folks who would like to ask a question today. And I'm going to lead off with a question, actually, which was that picture of Barcelona that you showed, the eclipse. And you said something about it being a picture of the same eclipse that happened 400 years ago.
Well, except that there was no eclipse going on then.
Except that there was no eclipse going on.
It's on the 400th anniversary of the 1605 eclipse, except that it's a lie, it wasn't. Because Shakespeare's time, they used the Julian calendar. We now use the Gregorian calendar, so there's a 10-day difference. So it really wasn't. So I should throw the picture out. But anyway.
That clarifies.
Yeah.
So I don't know much about astronomy or anything, so I'm curious, in terms of discovering the comet that hit Jupiter, like, how is it discovered? Did you discover it before the impact of Jupiter? Like, what's the time frame?
That's a good question. We did discover it before the impact, 17 months before. The impacts began in July of 1994, and the discovery was March 23rd, 1993. So we discovered it. We knew it was weird because it was broken up, as you can see in the early pictures. And we also knew, could figure out it was in orbit about Jupiter. The late Brian Marsden, who published the official newsletter and bulletin about the comet, announced in later in 1993 that there was going to be a collision. And that got everybody excited, the whole astronomical community. And much of it, much of the rest of the world as well, really got into it during 1 week in 1994. That's now 25 years ago. It's a long, long time. But in cosmic terms, it was nothing at all. In fact, collisions between comets and planets are common. They happen all the time. In fact, it's also possible that the planets were built from collisions that took place, especially in the early years. Now they're rare. The fact that we actually got to see one is almost unheard of. It's estimated that something about the size of that comet might hit Jupiter on an average of every 2,000 years or so. So this is really the first time that we were able to spot something like that. And using the then very young internet, we were able to spread images of it right away as it was happening. It was really a very interesting time. Good question. Thanks. Do you have one?
I find it really interesting, sort of parallels and connection to Shakespeare. It's always kind of a soft spot for different Shakespeare plays. In another life, I could have probably ended up going that path. But one of my favorites is actually, and I got thinking about, as you're talking, one of my favorites is The Tempest. And so there's a lot of allusions in that to, you know, the heavens and the moon and the stars. And all of that, and I guess the question I had, because you have some cool stories about other plays, is there anything that you've ever come across The Tempest, potentially not, but I thought I would?
I came across over, you kind of stumped me on a specific reference from The Tempest, but give me some homework. But I've come across over 200 astronomical references throughout this first folio of Shakespeare, which I think is enough to classify that book as a science book. I've been trying to arrange for a first folio to go to the Linda Hall Library of Science and Engineering to signify that it is a scientific treatise in a way, a scientific book. But one of my favorite later plays is Cymbeline. It was written in 1610, the year of Galileo and the moons of Jupiter. And there's a scene near the end when the main protagonist falls, he has a dream. And in his dream, he sees an apparition of Jupiter settling down from the ceiling, surrounded by four little angels, which could represent the four Galilean moons. So I think that's kind of neat. The other thing goes back to King Lear in a session kind of like this, except there were about a tenth the number of people. We were in a Shakespeare seminar at Queen's during my master's years. And we were talking about the old man going nuts and someone saying, well, this is what happens when you get older. She said, I hope it's not what happens when you get older. And I kind of mentioned without really thinking, I said, well, I'm putting up with that right now. And she said, why? And I said, well, my father has Alzheimer's disease and he's like dying every day as we watch. The whole class stopped, forgot about Shakespeare, talked about me and my dad for about 20 minutes, including the instructor, before we finally went back to King Lear. But the point I was trying to make was King Lear was at least Shakespeare was trying to write across the generations at that time. He was writing about the madness that occurred, that often accompanies old age, which is now often considered to be a form of Alzheimer's disease. It's one of the most common illnesses to older people. And that Shakespeare was writing across the generations and across the centuries. A real example was right there in Lear, I thought. Yeah, do you have a question?
I was actually interested in the prediction of the two moons of Mars in Jonathan Swift. Do you know, was there any discussion in the scientific field that could have inspired that, or do you know anything about where people came up with that? Because that's really fascinating.
It was, as far as I know, it was out of the blue. He was looking for material for that portion of Gulliver's Travels, and as far as I know, he's the first one to make the prediction. I won't put money on it. Actually, I will put a little money on it, but I don't think that anyone else. I think some people had thought that maybe other moons had, other planets had moons, but to get the sizes right and the orbits right, I thought that was amazing that he was able to do that 150 years out. It's really something. Yeah.
Was the War of the Worlds praise fueled by Percival Lowell?
Yeah, it was. Good question. Some of you may remember there was a, on CBS radio, there was a program, H.G. Wells' War of the Worlds, that they did, and they had an invasion from Mars. And people were listening to the radio and thought it was real, including, I remembered, the discoverer of the planet Pluto was sitting in his little house at Lowell Observatory with his wife, and his wife was listening to it, and she said, Clyde, you better come and hear this. And he came in, and they're talking about the explosion that they saw, the flash on Mars that represented the launch of the spacecraft carrying the invasion force. And Clyde's first comment was, well, I guess we're not alone in the universe. His second comment was, how could they have seen that 2 days ago? Mars is behind the sun right now. It's not visible in the evening sky. But it was a very, very famous thing, and a movie came out a number of years ago, not as good as the original, where they tried to redo it, a remake of it. Good question. Yes?
One of your images at the end was like a shot of planet Earth, and then there was this dark mark over, looked like North America. Like, was that some sort of representation of what might it look like if Earth were hit with a crunch or some disaster?
Very good. You've answered your own question. That's precisely what that was. During the week of impacts, people were saying, what if? What if it happened on Earth? Even then President Bill Clinton was saying that. He asked Congress if they could have a meeting and try to figure out a way that we could discover all the possibilities of impacts with the Earth in the next 100 years, which is rather forward thinking of him, I thought. Congress actually went along with it, and they knew that Gene was going to be in Washington area at that time. They asked him to drop by and share his insights with them, and he did. And he suggested that they mount the U.S. take the lead in a worldwide program to search for all the comets that could, and asteroids that could collide with Earth in the next 100 years. That program is still going on, has not found any objects that are likely to hit the Earth, but it has found a number of potential close calls coming up. But it's still going on, and we might see that, and hopefully we'll see that in time to kind of get out of the way before they hit.
So we've got to whisk David off to his next engagement, but I think we might have time for one more question if there's somebody else who's got a burning question. Going once, going twice. Okay, I think that's a wrap. We have a few extra copies of the poster, so if anybody would like to take one away with them, they'd be most welcome. Thanks so much for your attention today.
Thank you. Thanks. Thanks.